In the earlier days of the Final Fantasy franchise, jobs were a fundamental concept, and despite often being hidden in plain sight in the games that followed Final Fantasy V, they've seen something of a resurgence in more recent times through the arrival of Final Fantasy XI and Final Fantasy XIV. Now, when you think about jobs in general, some of the most iconic have to be the main trio of mage classes. Black mages are perhaps the most recognisable, and this popularity was only bolstered by Vivi's appearance in Final Fantasy IX. Then there are the white mages with their plush white robes trimmed in red triangles, and the dapper red mages with stylish red cloaks and feathered caps. They're among the oldest traditions in our beloved franchise. But as the job system developed over the years, so did the notion of what a mage could do and be. We saw the arrival of mages that could meddle with nature and time, as well as mages like the Blue Mage, that would have a unique affinity with the many monsters that are encountered as part of the overriding quest to save the world from destruction. Many of those who would be classified as a Blue Mage would be rather covert, humbly avoiding the spotlight since their origin, but there are common threads that can be tied back to that original appearance in Final Fantasy V. And with these enigmatic and understated sorcerers now taking the center stage in Final Fantasy XIV as the latest job in the game's ever-increasing ranks, what better time than now to explore the origins and evolutions of this particular job? So, without further ado, my name is Daryl, and today, in our super granular style, we're going to be exploring the evolution of Blue Mages across the entire Final Fantasy franchise. We'll be delving into what sets a Blue Mage apart from the other mages and how it's grown over the series' history so that we can understand where they have come from as they enter a new chapter in Eorzea. But before we kick things off with its introduction in Final Fantasy V, make sure you hit that subscribe button and notification bell, as we'll be looking to publish evolution videos on a more regular basis throughout 2019, as there are so many interesting topics to delve into. So, as mentioned, the Blue Mage job class was first introduced in 1992 with Final Fantasy V, and it could be obtained after the Wind Crystal shattered right at the start of the game. At this point in the franchise, we had of course been exposed to numerous mage jobs, but although they had started to deviate away from the standard white and black magic, they were still rather fundamental in how they operated. Aside from the red mage job, the majority of them were not considered capable of performing any significant physical feats, and to expand their knowledge, they would often rely on the acquisition of scrolls and tomes. Blue mages were designed to be different, and this didn't just relate to their unique gameplay mechanics, as their visual design was also rather distinctive. Alongside their glorious blue capes and red pauldrons, what helped to set the Blue Mages apart from every other job class in the game was the masks that they also wore, which were very reminiscent of what you'd expect a superhero to be wearing. Some of the characters even wore fancy feathered caps. I'd say the only other job that gives Blue Mage a run for its money in this regard is the Berserker, which sees some characters wearing full-on animal body suits. The true essence of the Blue Mage job, though, was their ability to learn skills or magic from enemies and claim the technique as their own. It meant that when a character was using the Blue Mage job, or using its passive ability called learning, and they were affected by certain abilities, they would then learn it, even if they died, as long as another member of the party managed to finish the fight. As with all other spells, once acquired, everyone else in the party would then be able to utilize it as long as they were using the Blue Mage job. For example, let's say that Bart was rocking the Blue Mage job when fighting against a Chimera. This enemy then used Aqua Breath. If Bart was hit by this particular attack, he would then learn it for use in later battles, like the Sandworm boss, which can then be healed in one hit by this particular move. In this debut, the available blue magic skills covered a broad spectrum of abilities, and this was down to its designation as a utility class. From an offensive perspective, not only did the Blue Mage gain access to powerful spells for rarer elements like Aqua Breath and Aero, but it also gave you access to classic attacks like a Thousand Needles and Goblin Punch. You also gained access to powerful defensive spells like Mighty Guard, which provided Protect, Shell and Float, as well as White Wind, which healed the party by the same amount of HP that the caster currently had at the time of casting. And on top of all of that, there were also some spells that inflicted status effects like Mini, Toad, and the rather unique Old status. It was a strange skill set to be sure, but it could make the job rather powerful in the right hands. You just have to go through the sometimes arduous process of acquiring the actual skills, which would often be made much easier by traveling with a beastmaster who could then manipulate enemies into using the desired skills. So there we have it, the essence of the Blue Mage. They have moderate magical power and physical power, but they also have access to a unique school of magic that is learnt from monsters. As such, the player must be diligent in seeking out these abilities if they want to maximize the command's potential, and some skills can even be permanently missed. Their magical strength is less than other mages, but they make up for this with abilities that don't solely rely on their magic stat. But even though the method of acquisition is different from the other mages, the spells still use MP when they're cast. Oh, and as a final point, they're also sharp dressers. So let's see how this new job trope was utilized in subsequent games, starting with Final Fantasy VI, which, like Final Fantasy IV, abandoned jobs, albeit in the traditional sense of being able to evolve or switch between them. Instead, the Blue Mage job class was assigned to Strago Magus. Except, in this game, the kooky old gaffer discarded the Blue Mage's style, and in the original Super Nintendo version, Blue Magic was also referred to as Lore, making his class the Lore Master. This may have been done to differentiate what he does compared to the magic that Terra can innately use and the rest of the party can also learn from magicites, or it may have just been a translation decision, as at this point, English audiences hadn't ever been exposed to a Blue Mage. Now, although he did do away with the title of Blue Mage in the game's original incarnation at least, and he also didn't look the part stylistically, Strago's lore ability did function in a very similar manner to what we saw with the original iteration in Final Fantasy V. The main difference here, though, was that he didn't need to be directly affected by the technique. Instead, he only needed to see the skill while being of sound mind. By that, I mean that if the spell was cast while he was KO'd, blinded, petrified, stopped, or affected by any skills that would rob him of his senses like Berserk, Confuse, or Zombie, then he wouldn't learn it. It was a rather unique twist on what we saw established in Final Fantasy V, as it meant that he could not only learn skills from enemies, but also from his granddaughter Realm, Gao, or Gogo if the right circumstances occurred. From a gameplay perspective, true to Blue Mage form, he wasn't the strongest caster in the game, but his abilities didn't often need raw magical power. By using level-based spells, unique elemental attacks and party buffs, as well as signature enemy attacks like the Marlborough's Bad Breath, and unusual attacks like Traveler, which dealt damage equal to 1/32nd of the total number of steps taken at that point in the game, Strago could be very dangerous and useful in certain situations. It meant that Strago did carry on the Blue Mage legacy, but it is worth noting that other characters within Final Fantasy VI could also use enemy attacks. Gao's Rage command allowed him to take on the qualities of certain enemies, including some of their attacks and lore-worthy techniques that Strago himself could learn. Realm's Sketch ability used the enemy's attacks against them, and Gogo could mimic the enemy's attacks. But as the franchise moved on to the PlayStation with Final Fantasy VII, job classes were set aside entirely. But despite this, Blue Magic was kept alive and well as the enemy's skill materia. This was obviously a significant departure from what we'd seen in the previous two games, but it was a rather accurate description of what the materia enabled the holder to do, as by equipping the materia, you would be able to use enemy skills that you had learnt so far throughout your playthrough. The challenge was that although it was similar, the learning process was made much more difficult than it had been in the previous two iterations of the Blue Mage. As we saw in Final Fantasy V, appropriate skills could be learnt in Final Fantasy VII by any character who was affected by them and also had an enemy skill materia equipped. How things differed was that the skills were now exclusive to an individual materia. This meant that it could be passed around the group, but if you picked up a new enemy skill materia on your travels, it would be blank and you'd have to go and learn the skills again. This was then compounded by there only being four versions of the enemy skill materia in the game, with none of them being mandatory acquisitions. One of them, the first that can be found inside Professor Hojo's lab shortly after Red 13 joins the party, is also missable. Another stipulation put on Blue Magic acquisition in this particular iteration is that the party must successfully complete the battle in order for the materia to retain the skill it has learnt. For example, Cloud can't fight the Midgar Zolom and then learn its beta attack, and then flee the battle with the attack learned. Cloud must defeat the Serpent. In similar fashion to Final Fantasy V, the Manipulate materia is also a handy companion to the enemy skill materia, allowing you to manipulate enemies into casting spells, and it makes you really appreciate Strago's learning style from Final Fantasy VI. The skill set was similar to previous games, but as it was no longer an exclusive trait to the character who wielded the materia, its impact was somewhat diminished. Due to this change, the attacks had a bit less utility, but some of them, like Beta, were still powerful due to there being no specific handicap to magic power as we had seen with the previous role-based iterations. Recurring skills like Mighty Guard, White Wind, Goblin Punch, Roulette, and Aqualung were also notable reoccurrences, while Shadow Flare was a cool addition to the Blue Magic school. For Final Fantasy VIII, what we then associate with the Blue Mage was again challenged, but while it did revert back to a common theme in some ways, in others it deviated even further from what had so far been established. As we saw in Final Fantasy VI, Blue Magic was now again exclusive to one character, and in Final Fantasy VIII, this character was Quistis. However, unlike the three previous iterations, Blue Magic now wasn't a general utility that could be used all the time, as it was reserved as Quistis' limit break. It meant that for the first time, Blue Magic didn't use MP when cast. The method of learning techniques was also changed to be more in line with the other characters in Final Fantasy VIII, as Quistis didn't need to experience a Blue Magic skill at all. Instead, she learnt them by using items dropped by enemies. Therefore, it was possible to teach Quistis every single Blue Magic skill available to her, while still keeping her benched at every opportunity when those skills were used in battle. Classic skills like White Wind and Mighty Guard did return, but due to the nature of when Blue Magic was used, both defensive and offensive attacks were now much more powerful, especially if the situation was rather dire. Some of her more notable attacks were Ray Bomb, the same attack used by the arachnid X-ATM-092 robot that she slays right at the start of the game, and Shockwave Pulsar, the signature ability of a certain final boss, which also had the ability to break damage cap. With Final Fantasy IX, which of course acted as a tribute to everything that had come before, the developers felt that Blue Mages, and by proxy, Blue Magic, were representative enough of what the franchise was about to warrant a place, and they chose the Final Fantasy VI iteration as a specific base. It meant that Quina Quen, the aspiring Q Chef, was assigned as a Blue Mage, and Blue Magic would then be exclusive to this character. However, while this aspect was the same as we'd seen with Strago, the method of learning saw another further deviation, as in a unique twist, skills weren't learnt by being affected by them, watching them, or by using items dropped by them. They were now learnt by eating the enemy that used them via the Devour command. Yes, for the uninitiated, Quina can literally eat a weakened enemy and learn a skill from it, if it has one of course. This was of course in keeping with Quina's demeanour in the wider narrative, so it seemed like an apt method, but it also represented another slight evolution on a concept previously seen. In Final Fantasy VIII, the Devour ability could be learnt from Guardian forces, and it was also used as a way of benefiting characters from eating weakened enemies. In this particular instance, it could be used to, amongst other things, increase a character's base stats. It was just a little bit less expected. Going back to Quina, even though the method of learning new skills was changed, the effects were very similar. Spells with gimmicks that circumvented Quina's lesser casting ability compared to the other mages. The signature ability this time around was Frog Drop, which dealt damage based on character level and how many frogs have been caught in the Q's Marsh minigame. Many of the classic spells such as Aqua Breath, Roulette, Mighty Guard, and White Wind returned, and due to the change in acquisition method, Final Fantasy IX's version of Matra Magic was also made particularly useful for learning other blue magics, as it reduced the target's HP to 1 and made them much easier to devour. It meant that Final Fantasy IX saw a more classic representation of the Blue Mage, but with Final Fantasy X, the decision was made to revert back to what we saw in Final Fantasy VIII. The character of focus this time around was Kimahri, who also happened to be blue. Like Quistis in Final Fantasy VIII, Kimahri's usage of blue magic was restricted to his overdrive command, which was called Ronso Rage, but the acquisition of moves was similar to what we saw in Final Fantasy IX, as Kimahri just needed to use his Lancet ability on specific enemies to learn their unique ability. Due to its restricted use, as we saw with Quistis, the pool of available skills was quite shallow, but there was still room for some classic moves like White Wind, Mighty Guard, Doom, and Bad Breath. Kimahri's most notable spell though was Nova, a non-elemental magical attack that bypassed magical defenses, and under certain circumstances, this particular move can deal the most possible damage in the game from a single hit. Within the lore of Final Fantasy X, the role of Blue Mage also seemed to be assigned to the Ronzo in general, as both Biran and Yenke also have a repository of enemy skills that they can use. Kimahri can also learn 8 of his 12 possible techniques from their duel on Mount Gagazet. But the Ronzo aren't the only Blue Mages who reside in Spira, as the job class returned in Final Fantasy X-2 as the Gun Mage. While using this snazzy dress sphere, Yuna, Riku and Pain can use the skill Blue Bullet, and the method of acquisition reverted back to a combination of what we saw in Final Fantasy V and VII. Characters would learn skills once they had been affected by them in battle, but skills were unique to each individual character. Within this particular game, there was no way of actively manipulating enemies though, so classic spells like White Wind and Mighty Guard could only be learnt by confusing enemies instead. Final Fantasy X-2 also created the first real evolution of the Blue Mage job, as not only could Gun Mages learn and use enemy skills, they could also study enemies and inflict more damage against certain types through the use of the Fiend Hunter command. We next saw the Blue Mage job in Final Fantasy XI, when it appeared alongside Corsair and Puppet Master as one of the new jobs in the game's third expansion, Treasures of Artugan. Here, players could journey to a new continent with Ivanadiel that had a distinct Middle Eastern influence, and perhaps because of this, Blue Mages looked rather different from what we'd previously seen in Final Fantasy V. Their garb was much more suited to the expansion's desert setting, and they didn't show much outward sign of their magical inclinations. However, those who underwent the initiation to join the Blue Mage ranks gained access to the largest pool of blue magic spells we'd ever seen, and learning them was accomplished in a way that we'd also never seen before. Now an enemy simply needed to be defeated. However, learning a new skill on the first attempt was not guaranteed. The player needed to be an appropriate level to learn the skill, and even then, there was still a chance that it wouldn't take on the first try. Once a Blue Mage had learned a given skill, they would then have to set it before it could be used, and of course, higher level Blue Mages could naturally set more spells. The interesting aspect here was that spells affected statistics. Setting Blood Drain, for example, would increase the character's MP by 5, but decrease their HP by 5. As we had seen in Final Fantasy V, Blue Mages weren't necessarily restricted to using magic as their sole means of offense, and in Final Fantasy XI, this carried through, as while they were no means the best, Blue Mages could still be rather adept at physical combat. One rather unique aspect of the Blue Mage in this particular game though, was that for the first time, we gained some kind of understanding about how exactly they function and are able to learn and use unique techniques of monsters. The answer was rather disturbing, as it was revealed that to become a Blue Mage, one would have to themselves become a monster. And for this reason, blue magic is treated as a forbidden or taboo craft in Vanadiel, as its practitioners literally absorb a monster's soul into their own. In the quest which granted access to the job, the player is tested and alchemically altered by Rauban, the leader of Artugan's Immortals. The Immortals are militant Blue Mages in service of the Desert Empire, and they created the School of Magic by infusing monsters' souls into their own. This process led many Blue Mages to ultimately become monsters, losing their humanity to the monsters within and becoming Soul Flayers. These monsters were akin to the Mind Flayers seen in many of the earlier Final Fantasies, and like the Four Fiends, are another link to the series' roots in tabletop role-playing games like Dungeons & Dragons. It marked the first time in the job class's history that the powers were truly explored. Strago, Quistis and others were simply able to mimic these specific spells without consequence or explanation, the same way that any other mage might learn a spell from a vendor or upon leveling up, but outside of this particular aspect, the job was very faithful to what we had seen in earlier iterations. Which was actually rather fitting, as despite being ever present since Final Fantasy V, Blue Mages were absent in Final Fantasy XII, XIII, and XV, which brings us on to the latest addition to the job class's lineage, as Final Fantasy XIV is adding the Blue Mage to Eorzea, and it looks like the perfect amalgamation of every single appearance that has come so far. First of all, the classic look from Final Fantasy V is back. With a cloak, cane, mask, and a feather in the cap, the newest incarnation looks like the original's 2D sprite brought to life in high-definition 3D. The announcement trailer leaned into this, showcasing a Blue Mage strutting his stuff and twirling his cane. It's like the party of Final Fantasy V at the Blue Mage formal. As you'd expect, skills are learnt from enemies, and the method of acquisition is very similar to what we saw with Strago, combined with what we saw in Final Fantasy XI. It means that to learn a new skill, players must witness an enemy perform it in battle. Once the enemy has then been defeated, there's a chance of acquiring the ability. Job level, though, has no influence on whether a skill can be learnt. At the moment, there are around 50 different skills to learn, including 1000 Needles, Mighty Guard, Bad Breath, and White Wind, but this class is designated to be more suitable for solo players, and it will have its own special mode called Masked Carnival for players to test their skills. As it's so new though, it's hard to say exactly how this interpretation will fit into the game's wider lore, but as it stands, the Blue Mages of Eorzea look like they will be a faithful step forward for the job, combining the best of its past. And that about does it for the mainline games. But this more obscure class of mages has had an impact outside of the mainline series, appearing in numerous spin-offs. In both Tactics Advance and its sequel Tactics A2, Blue Mages dressed the part. Their mechanics functioned as you'd expect too. You need to be hit by a spell while the learn ability was equipped to learn a spell and use it as desired. However, for these particular games, only humans could use the class, which was an interesting deviation. Blue Mages also appeared in Final Fantasy Explorers, and their representation was more akin to what we saw in Final Fantasy VI. See a monster, use a skill, slay it, and learn it later from the central crystal. And while Bravely Default and Bravely Second may not be Final Fantasy games in name, the Blue Mage is one of the job classes that the game borrowed, appearing as the Vampire and Catmancer asterisks respectively. This was a rather interesting twist, as if Blue Mages do indeed absorb the essence of their foes, it is rather similar to a vampiric attack. Lastly, the job class also makes cameo appearances in Final Fantasy Type-0 as the Class 12 Moogle, and Lightning Returns Final Fantasy XIII as a Garb, but in this particular instance it didn't have any of the hallmark abilities. Nonetheless, it means that even though the Blue Mage only appeared within the fifth iteration of the franchise for the first time, its influence on the games that followed was very clear to see. Sure, it often hasn't manifested itself front and center like other, more standard job classes like White Mage and Black Mage, and when it has appeared it often hasn't represented the most powerful option available, but there's just a unique charm, and I think that's why developers have always been so keen to accommodate it in their games despite numerous tweaks often being necessary to do so. Final Fantasy XIV, the most recent incarnation, is perhaps the most obvious example of this, as the job will bring numerous firsts to the game. What's also particularly interesting about this job is that it's one of the few instances where its source of power has actually been explained. The nature of learning magic is glossed over in the majority of Final Fantasy games, but the Blue Mage's methods were eventually explored, and they raise questions about the practitioners who came before this. Would a similar fate have awaited Strago? Was Quina able to learn the craft due to essentially already being a monster? It's also interesting to speculate where the class could go from here. With that particular aspect of lore now out there in the public domain, is that something that would need to be incorporated into future characters who exhibit the traits of a Blue Mage? It would certainly be interesting to see the lore established in Final Fantasy XI applied to a fully fledged character in a future mainline game, to see the toll taken upon someone like Quistis or Strago when they become part monster. And of course, we'll have to see how this class is established in Final Fantasy XIV and how it changes through future updates. Either way, what has been your favourite incarnation of the job class so far? Be sure to let us know in the comments, and also let us know your impressions of what you've seen so far in Final Fantasy XIV. Be sure to also hit that like button and subscribe to our channel for more future Final Fantasy content, as we have plenty more evolution topics to explore. This video represented the fourth evolution video we've done, but it was also our first dive into the jobs that have been recurring throughout the series. We're always on the lookout for fresh new areas of interest to delve into though, so be sure to let us know in the comments if there are any specific ones you'd like us to take a look at. Also, if you value what we do, why not consider supporting us on Patreon? As we've mentioned before, this video series actually started out as a suggestion from a Patreon supporter, and it's just one of the rewards we offer. Another is getting your name seen at the end of videos like these guys you're seeing right now. Alright guys, thank you so much for watching. This is Daryl signing out. I'll see you all very soon for more Final Fantasy videos. Blah 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 blah.